The Joe Rogan Experience.
Dude, I've bombed a lot.
I just can't believe that. I had George Lopez on my podcast 2 days ago, and he was talking about bombing, but yeah. You're fucking Fred Rogan, you're Joe Rogan, he's fucking, you know, George Lopez, what the fuck, how do you guys don't bomb?
You have to come up with new material, and if you're going to come up with new material, some of them are going to be duds. That's just how it is. Yeah. And also, you have to take chances if you want to expand. Like, comedy is, there's a bunch of things going on. Right? There's you relating to the audience. There's them liking you. There's these concepts you're trying to flesh out. And especially the workout room, like the Comedy Store, like you have to take chances. There's no way around it. And sometimes those chances fall flat on their face. But the good thing is through those painful failures, those are like the biggest springboards to improvement and growth. Like every time I've ever had a bad set, my next set has been amazing because you just feel the sting and you prepare better. And also, like, I think my past bombings have prepared me to not bomb again because of the fact that I know what it feels like to suck.
Dude.
It's so, I always explain it that it's like, if someone said, what's bombing like? It's like sucking 1,000 dicks in front of your mother. Except there's probably someone out there that likes sucking 1,000 dicks in front of their mother. No one likes bombing. You know, there's probably some guy who's just really into humiliation, but I don't think there's no one out there who's into bombing.
Oh man, I just
yeah. Well, because it's like
oh well, listen. Look, what am I? I will bet you that no one has bombed harder than me.
Bro, that's not possible.
But I will.
You need to come to the Comedy Store.
I will.
And open
I,
mic
no,
night.
Bro.
How is it possible?
That no I. One's bombed? By the way, your trusty savant next to us,
young Jamie,
will pull up.
Did you do stand up?
He can pull up me bombing. In front of a billion people.
What did you do?
The Academy Awards.
Ooh, you hosted it?
Well, here's the thing. So, you talk about bombing. My dick's bigger than your dick about bombing. I'm 24 years old. I'm doing my movies. The Academy Awards ask me to do a big opening number for them. I'm like, holy fucking shit. This
Can we
is,
play it?
This is a yeah, yeah.
We'll get pulled off of YouTube? Yeah.
God damn it.
These motherfuckers.
So,
I'll play it for us.
So, wait, before you play it, before okay. I get a little context,
no context.
Stop! Stop or I'll bomb again. I'll bomb right now. Again. So, they say to me, they go, we want you to do, and I'm like,
what this year is this?
High honor, 86.
Okay.
High
honor.
Fucking Academy Awards.
Yeah, sure.
And I should have, like, probably thought it through because the idea didn't sound great to me. But it's the Academy Awards. You know, they know better than I do. It's their right. show. And the idea is it's going to be an homage to old-time Hollywood. And one of the earliest stars in Hollywood was Snow White, the animated figure. So we're going to have a girl obviously playing Snow White, and we're going to do a duet because it's a big opening musical number. The Oscars always used to open with musical numbers before there were monologues.
Really?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yes. This ended it. It's ended it. I'm like, okay. Me and Snow White, great. Okay. And anyway, Marvin Hamlisch. Is going to write it. Marvin Hamlisch. I'm like, I know Marvin Hamlisch is. He wrote The Sting. Da-na-na-na-na-na. Well, Scott Joplin wrote The Sting, but Marvin Hamlisch won the Academy Award for that. He's a double Oscar. He's a genius. And, you know, I'm not going to tell Marvin Hamlisch that I think that the lyrics are cheesy. I'm not going to do that. So when they get Ike and Tina Turner's Proud Mary and change the lyrics to, did a lot of work for Walt Disney.
Ooh.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Oh, no. I'm saying, it's a bomb.
Okay.
It's a,
I'm you not, and I are going to watch this, and we're going to pause for the people at home. If you need to watch this, YouTube, Jamie, what is it? What is it?
It's on the Hollywood Reporter's website. I don't know why it's there. It probably is somewhere
What is
else,
the title of the actual video?
Rob Lowe Bombs?
Yeah,
is that
something
title?
Like that. Disastrous Open. I don't know.
Rob Lowe and Snow White's disastrous Oscar opening February 20th.
By the way, that's actually the title for the people. It literally says disastrous. Mm-hmm.
Okay, folks at home, Google this, watch it, and then we're gonna pick this up after Rob and I watch this.
Miss
Is that Lily Tomlin at the end? No, that's a truncated version.
They didn't give you much of it.
But can I tell you something?
We're back.
That was the year that Barry Levinson.
I could tell just from the first bar.
It's not
good. It was going to be bad. Yeah, when you were singing. Did you take singing lessons?
No, fuck.
Found the whole thing.
What's that? You found the whole thing?
It's 11 minutes long.
No, it's 11 minutes of sheer terror.
That's on YouTube if you want to look at that.
Oh, okay. Of 11 minutes that ruined Hollywood producer Alan Carr's career forever. Hold on. We'll be right back.
He's like, wait, just hang on.
Hang on, folks. I need to see.
First of all,
I get it. Okay,
we're back. So I look out in the middle. I look out in the middle of the audience, and I see Barry Levinson. So he's at this Oscars. He's about to win literally 11 Academy Awards as an actor. There's no one you would want to impress more than Barry Levinson. It's the year of Rain Man, and I look out, Joe, in the middle of this, and I see his face. I'm not kidding. And he went like this. What the fuck?
You see him actually make those?
I see him mouth the words, what the fuck? And so, talk about bombing. And I'm like, but you know, we have to have our actor's denial. Like, we can't get through a career without a healthy dose of denial. So I'm like, you know what? Fuck Barry Levinson. What does he know anyway? Fuck that guy. And I go backstage, and it's in the green room, and it's early because it's early in the show. And there's an older lady in the corner with like flaming red hair, and I'm kind of looking at her, and she sees me, and she goes, "Young man, I didn't know you were such a good singer. Come sit down." It was Lucille Ball.
Whoa!
And I went over, and we sat down, and she held my hand, and we watched the Oscars together. And you know what? It made it all almost worthwhile. Almost.
Here's why that's not as bad as bombing doing stand-up.
How is that not as bad?
It's not as bad. Because even though a billion people watched it, A, you didn't write it, and B, you knew where you were going. You could just sing the stupid song and get it over with. It's terrible. It's bombing. It's bad. But when you're bombing doing stand-up, you are the writer, you are the creator, you are the performer.
Mm.
You put it together, you edited it, wow. You prepared it, you got it ready, and then you're just up there eating shit. and people are angry at you. They're angry. They're angry because they can talk.
Oh, they were angry.
Oh, I'm sure.
They were angry. Here's the other thing they did that it never occurred to the Academy to maybe that they needed to license the likeness of Snow White.
What?
Oh yeah.
Oh no.
Oh yeah.
So they get sued?
And you know how Disney is about likenesses.
Oh,
they're so easygoing.
Yeah, they're so generous.
So generous. So I would have thought I think I would have gotten away with it a little bit in terms of history, had there not been massive lawsuits the next day.
Oh.
Over the likeness thing, which
also
made
then people thought about
when
it again.
People went back and went, wait a minute, that fucking sucked way worse. than I thought it did.
What was the next thing you did after that?
I think, let's see, would it have been, I feel like it might have been Bad Influence with James Spader and Kurt, one of my favorite movies.
Great movie.
I love that movie.
That's a good way to bounce back.
That was a good one.
Let's look at the bright side.
Yeah. No, listen, and it is a...
Did you consider saying no?
No, a people-pleasing Midwesterner at 24
right.
does not say no to the Academy of Motion Picture Arts and Sciences. They don't. And every year I am treated to the honor, the high honor, of being on the list of most embarrassing Oscar moments every fucking year. And my thing is this, is I go, hey, wait, guys, you couldn't figure out how to announce the best picture 2 years ago, and I'm the problem? Still?
Well, it wasn't your fault. I mean, no one would have saved that. No one. No one. Not a fucking human being could have jumped up there and sang that and had it made any sense. Maybe Jim Carrey. Maybe.
Yes, maybe Jim Carrey.
Maybe Jim Carrey could have done it. But he would have gone full Ace Ventura, over the top. And people would have been just laughing hysterically at how crazy he is.
It's one of my great career lowlights/highlights. It actually kind of makes me laugh with the onset of perspective in history.
That's the beautiful thing about failures. They eventually become funny. And they can
yes.
look back at them.
It only took 30 years. It's great.